my illustrious guest. You know what it is. Meryl, who we got in the building tonight?
We got Democratic congressional nominee Jamal Bowman, the guard in the house. You know what I'm saying? Make some noise.
Give it up
for
the Bowman. First of all, congrats on your
resounding
win.
Resounding.
What is it?
Resounding victory over Elliot Engel, dog. He dunked on Elliot Engel with the strength of 10 Shaquille O'Neal.
Definitely. And as two lifelong Bronx residents, we've known Elliot Engel. We've known the name. We've seen the face. He's been around our whole entire lives. Like, he was just a fixture in Bronx politics. What was it like going up against him? Because that was a very daunting task.
It was tremendous. It was exciting. I mean, from the very beginning, you know, we had the people behind us. We knew we had the people behind us. So it was pretty much a people versus the machine situation. And we launched June 18th, 2019, the day before Juneteenth in 2019. And from the very beginning, man, you know, people young and old, rich and poor, black, white, you know, Jewish, Christian, everyone was excited about us and supported us from the beginning. It's because I've been in this district for 10 years as a principal. So I had thousands of relationships coming in, man. So it was daunting, but it was exciting. And, you know, we were able to get it done.
So talk about that a little bit, because as a former principal, like, a lot of people don't realize running a New York City public school is not a cushy job. Like, talk about that a little bit, because people think it's just like, you're a principal, you're making X amount of dollars a year, you're good. But there's a lot of responsibility that comes with it.
Yeah, there's a lot of responsibility. And I often got the question, well, you know, how does being a principal, how does education prepare you for Congress? And I was like, I'll challenge anyone in Congress to come run a middle school effectively, particularly in the Bronx, particularly right around the corner from Boston Secor Projects, right? So in terms of the poverty, the trauma, the violence, the depression, the mental health issues, you know, that's something that principals deal with on a day-to-day basis. So I encourage all principals across the country to run for Congress because we have a perspective and empathy because of those experiences that Congress needs right now. I mean, when they talking all this political jargon and nonsense way above the issues, when the issues are our children, the issues are our families, the issues are racism, as we know, and classism. And being a principal, man, prepares you for all that. Teachers as well. I mean, teachers deal with it on daily basis in their classroom. So
preach.
Any educator, man, I encourage them to run for Congress, run for office at every level.
Now, when you went into this campaign against Elliot Engel, you know, it started regular campaign stuff. And I remember I was sitting there watching TV, and all of a sudden this wild ad came on where they went into like your financial background, and the people were like, the lady's voice was weird, and they were bringing up like taxes you owe, like stuff that had nothing to do with the election. Did you realize the election was going to get that dirty and that personal? And how did you respond?
Yeah, I was warned about that from the very beginning. People were like, yo, man, you know, they're going to look into your history. They're going to peel back the layers. And I knew I had nothing crazy in my history, so I wasn't super worried about it. And when I saw the ads, like, it just seemed like desperation to me. Like, the recent poll, the polling definitely showed us that we were ahead. Everyone knew that the people were behind us. So when I saw an ad talking about I owe thousands of dollars, first of all, it was 2,000, literally just reached the threshold of thousands. And it was from like 14 years ago.
Right.
And I didn't even know about it until like they did their research and it came up. I'm like, oh, all right, I'll just contact the state and take care of that. So it was a desperation move. I file and pay taxes every year, so I wasn't worried about it. Listen, when you're a black man in America, you don't pay taxes, you go to jail. That's number one.
Because
I worked for the city for 20 years, and you don't pay taxes. The city, they take your money.
You know what I'm saying?
So exactly. I was like, whatever. And the people saw right through that, man. And that's why they came out and supported
us. And like, another thing that really inspired me about your campaign is like, having the background of a principal, like, just getting in front of a crowd of people. Like you said, like, if you can command the attention of an auditorium full of tweens and early teenagers and young adults, you can dominate a White House press core or whatever. You know what I'm saying? Like, the right way, though. Not the
That's
way this blows
up. I mean, we had something every Friday in our school called Community Circle. And it was pretty much a weekly assembly. And it was a chance for me and the staff to come together with our students and just celebrate our culture, build our community, shout out kids, shout out teachers who were doing well. And then we had something in place where if a kid did something against the culture or if a teacher did something against the culture, they would stand up and make a public apology. so they would acknowledge the harm that they caused against the community so that we can all move on and support them and move on collectively. So we did that every Friday. So I did that every Friday for 10 years. So in terms of sharpening the message, like you said, to your point, for middle school kids and keeping their attention, yeah, we had, I had a lot of practice with that. And it was amazing how much I had to use that experience throughout the campaign trail, because I was talking not just to Black and brown people, but people from another part of the district who are incredibly wealthy and not used to engaging with someone with my background. So it all paid off, man. It was all helpful.
How do you feel about this, like, wave of progressives coming in, like, and kind of, like, replacing, like, that old guard of, like, you know, I represent this district, but I don't even live in this.
It's incredible, man. I mean, you know, we all learned about the civil rights movement, you know, while we were in school and while we were growing up. It feels like we're living through another civil rights movement right now. The difference is not only do we have the protests, but we have people running for office and winning congressional seats. So that's huge, right? We can take the energy and the passion and the brilliance of the protesters and the grassroots that have been fighting for these issues for decades. We take all of that energy and now bring it into Congress. Listen, we're picking up the baton from where Dr. King and Fred Hampton and Rosa Parks and all of them left it. They passed the baton to us. Now it's our job to do what we need to do when we get into the halls of Congress, man. So it's exciting. It's a blessing. I'm tired of it happening in relation to Black people being killed by the police. Like, we need to do that, need to stop. Mm-hmm. And we're going to pass policies to make that stop. But it's great to see the uprisings, man. Even in this district, you know, some of the whitest, wealthiest areas of the district, they have the Black Lives Matter rallies with 2,000 people in attendance. So it's a shift. Something is changing now, and we need to keep that momentum going.
Definitely. And on that fact, well, me and Meryl were talking the other day, you know, we realized we're from the Bronx, we're brown people, and it's like we have a platform. We do jokes on here and everything, but we realize we have a community service to do. And, you know, with the upcoming election, it's Trump, probably going to be against Biden. And a lot of our fans are kind of like iffy on Biden. You know what I'm saying? Like, how do we invigorate these voters? How do we get people to see that, like, you might not be in love with him, but it's bigger than that?
Listen, vote for Biden. Tell your friends and family across the country to vote for Biden. And here's why. Donald Trump is a racist. He's a fascist. He don't care nothing about democracy. He cares less about Black and brown people. And my worry is, if he gets another 4 years, we're going to have a Hitler Germany situation on our hands. And we can't mess around with that. He's already the most dangerous president of our lifetime, maybe even in history. I mean, look, because of his incompetence, we have over 120,000 people dead from the coronavirus, disproportionately Black and brown.
Yeah.
And he don't care. He could care less. Mm-hmm. He retweeted a white supremacist tweet the other day. I mean, he's dog whistling the white supremacist and blatant showing that level of racism. And he's emboldening and empowering white supremacists to come out and do what they're doing. So Biden, you know, I understand the critique, and the critique is well warranted, but we have to do everything in our power to get him in the office and hold him accountable. And that's the thing, right? We have to hold him accountable to the needs of the people, not just in this district, but across the country. And one of the reasons why I ran is to make sure that people can see someone like me involved in politics and then hopefully lean in more to the political arena, not just at a congressional level, but local levels as well, because we need everyone involved to make sure Biden is held accountable going forward.
All right, now I got to ask you the spicy question that might derail your campaign and get you banished from the airways for life. Are you a Knicks fan?
Yes, I am, sir. Yes, I am.
Oh, come on, man. I had hope for you. I had hope. You got to be better than this.
Listen, but look, but Jamal, that all that taught you was perseverance. You know what I mean? And like, there's a light at the end of the tunnel. We'll get through
keeping
this.
Keep your eye open for the bigger picture. It taught you to be a better person. So
you know,
it's a good thing.
I must be a masochist to not just be a Knicks fan, but to go into politics. My campaign manager, Luke Hayes, says running for office is an unnatural state of affairs. And being a Knicks fan is kind of that way as well. You're in a constant state of torture. I mean, how do we, everything look perfect for us to get the number one pick and get Zion? It seems like it was the writing on the wall. And now Zion, we miss out on Ja Morant as well, man. Like, So it's like, man, we can't even get the number two pick. And no disrespect to RJ Barrett, man, but like we need something else. We need something different, man. So
Listen, man, all I do every night after I put the kids in bed is sit down and watch Ja Morant highlights on YouTube and cry.
We bring in Phil Jackson and pay him $100 million or whatever we paid him. And he drafts Frank Ntilikina over Donovan Mitchell. Like, it's like we can't get nothing right, dog.
We can't win.
We can't win even with Phil Jackson, man. Don't remind me, man. And then it was a report the other day. See, you got me started now. There was a report the other day. When they teased us with LeBron James was considering the Knicks before a bad meeting, I'm like, why are you even bringing that up? Why are you bringing that up right now? First of all, it's 10 years too late. Why are we talking about this? It's like, to be a Knicks fan is to live in consistent torture. I need Jay-Z and Diddy to put together a team to buy the team from James Dolan. That's what I'm looking for.
Listen, Diddy and Jay-Z, you heard it from the Democratic congressional nominee. He's calling on you.
You know what I'm saying?
All right?
He's coming in. He's coming into the halls of Congress.
Defund the Knicks. Something.
Defund the Knicks. That's what we're talking about. That's the new platform. Yo, Jamal, we know you are a busy man. You got a lot of things to do. We want to congratulate you again for your win. We can't wait to see you doing your thing in the government. And now we know everyone that comes on our show is illustrious. They get a neon sign like in the bodega. What would your neon sign say?
Neon sign in the bodega?
Yeah, in the window. I mean, hot pizza.
Wu Tang forever, man. It would say Wu Tang forever.
Whoa! Whoa! Jamal with the witty, unpredictable talent and natural game. Wu-Tang forever. Yes.
No doubt. The bodega for sure.
Listen, if you weren't sold on him before, you got to be now, yo. Give it up.
Thank you, brothers. Peace and love, man. We'll talk soon.
Jamal, yo, man, bro.
We definitely will. We got to have you back on the show, man.
Listen, man. As a former educator, man, I'm super proud of you, man. Keep doing your thing, bro.
Yes, man. Thank you. All the Bronx sends you love, bro. Jamal Bowman in that building, y'all.
Peace and love, y'all.